for the truth of that. You may be seated as we go to prayer. Father God, I'm so grateful, and I imagine many here are grateful. It's not up to us. It's in your hands. You are the creator and the giver of life. You are the healer of our hearts, our souls, our bodies. You are the one who delivers us when it seems as if all is lost. You are the one who brings peace when it seems like everything around us is in chaos. You are the answer when we are filled with so many questions. And we pause right now, Lord, in this service and say, Lord, we need you. We need you more than we've ever needed you. And it seems like Satan lately, over the last several weeks, months, has been dancing a jig, but then again, we also know he knows his time is running short. And Lord, he has disillusioned people. He's discouraged, brought them to moments and points of despair. But God, you're not the God of despair. You're not the God of discouragement. You're the God of hope. And so, Father, we come before you this morning, and we lift our voices to you in love and praise and adoration. And we say, thank you, Lord, for all that you brought into our lives. Even if it's bad, different, or ugly. Because, Lord, that has all shaped us to become the man or the woman of God you've called us to be and become. As long as we keep our focus on you. And today, once again, we come here in this place. We weren't forced to be here. We came on purpose. We came because, Lord, we believe you have a message for us. We came because, Lord, we need to hear from heaven today. We need the fellowship of fellow brothers and sisters. So, Lord, this is not something we take lightly. We believe that, Lord, when we leave this place today, we will be energized by your Spirit, and that, Father, we leave with strength in our spiritual well-being. And we thank you, Lord, for many answers to prayer. Lord, there's many of us who know for a fact that, Lord God, you've touched us and brought healing to our bodies. But right now, we lift up Mary Ellen Murphy to you and ask, oh God, that you would bring sweet relief from the pain, from the disease, and Lord, heal her body. We ask this in your Son's name. We ask, believing, knowing that, Lord, you have our best interests at heart. So, Father, keep your hand upon her. Be close to Mike today. Be close to Aaron, Lord. We know he'd rather be with his mother, but now he's dealing with some of these very same issues. And, Father, I just pray you protect him as well. Then we think of Barb and Dennis, and we're grateful, Lord, they're doing so much better. But, Lord, I just pray that the healing process will continue. And Steve and Diana May, I pray, God, that you just be close to them and, Lord, touch them. Touch Steve, Lord. It just seems to be getting worse, not better. And it's overwhelming when a wife sees her husband decline. Keep your hand on Jan Johannes as well. There's so many, Lord, that we could present to you. We could be here all day talking about our needs and talking about and asking you to touch people's lives and bodies. But, Lord, the most important need we have is a spiritual need, that we won't get disenchanted by what's going on, that, Lord, we won't, Lord, buy into Satan's lies and dumb down Christianity so that, Lord God, we just feel better about ourselves. Because, Lord, it's not about necessarily feeling better about ourselves. It's about being on the same page with you. It's about following your word in your holy book and recognizing that, Lord, maybe there's some changes that we need to make in our lives. And so, Father, today is that day. Today is an opportunity for us to hear from you and how we can draw closer to you, how we can be faith warriors for you. So, Father, I'm just asking right now, God, that you would take this service and make it everything you want it to be, not what Grant Foster wants it to be, but, Lord, everything that we need to hear from you in regards to our lives. We love you and thank you, Lord, for this privilege you extend to us, and ask this in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen. Well, I got to preach. I guess it's come to that. It's like the old people say, well, I guess we better pray. Has it come to that already? Yeah, it's come to that. I just want to ask you a question. How do you get God's approval in your life? How do you get God's smile on your life? Because after all, one of these days we will be standing before the judgment bar of God, where we will all be judged. So how do we make sure that we have God's approval? Is it by doing more good things than bad things? No. Is it by keeping the Ten Commandments? Oh, that's good, but no. Is it promising to be perfect? No. Is it by being religious and going to church? Although going to church is a good thing, no. There's only one thing that we can do that will bring God's approval on our lives. And the word of God is very clear in Hebrews chapter 11. He says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith. You may be the greatest person around, but if you don't have faith, doesn't amount to hill beans. You're not going to be pleasing God. You may do all kinds of philanthropic things that are just awesome. You might be just phenomenal things. But if you don't do it with faith, you're missing the mark. You're missing out. So would you say that faith is a pretty big deal? I hope you would say yes, because if you say no, you're dismissed. Because I can't help you. You see, the whole line of thinking here, the whole understanding is this is God's word. This is what we live on. This is our only source of authority. I can sit here and give you statistics ad nauseum about a lot of different things, spiritual. I can give you a lot of statistics about baseball. If you want to hear them, I'll bore you to tears if you don't like baseball. Those of you who like baseball would enjoy those. Three-fingered Mordecai Brown from the 1907 Cubs. He was good. Three-finger because he shot his hand off, shot his fingers off. But it made him an excellent pitcher. I digress. See what I'm saying? Bottom line is, we have to learn how to live by faith. We have to learn how we can get our faith strengthened. Like the old adage, like the old couple. And she says to her husband, she says, well, how come you never say you love me anymore? He said, well, I told you I loved you when I got married, and if that changes, I'll let you know. There are people who, when it comes to faith, they think, well, I exhibited faith when I got saved, and that's all that I need. That's good enough. But folks, how many know that we need to strengthen our faith? Because Satan is constantly trying to drain your faith. He's trying to, and by draining your faith, he can get you discouraged. And when he gets you discouraged, he can get you to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And pretty soon you'll find yourself on the other side of the door and wonder how in the world he got there. So we got to strengthen our faith. This, my friends, is our faith food. You got to get God's word in your heart and life. Now, sometimes you may only know one or two scriptures. That's called fast faith food. But bottom line is, we got to get God's word into our hearts and lives. And I'll tell you what, a great scripture is Matthew 9:29. In the NIV, it says this: according to your faith, it will be done to you. Jesus is talking about there. God is saying that you and I have a choice here. According to your faith, it will be done to you. You get to choose how much God blesses you. You get to choose how many answers you get to the prayers that you're praying. You get to choose how much God gets to use you in his plan for this whole world that you and I are living in. How? According to your faith, it will be done to you. God says, if you got a lot of faith, you get a lot of things done. You got a little faith, you get a little things done. If you have no faith, you get nothing done. Well, you can say, well, no, I don't know. I don't know that I agree with that, Grant, because, you know, I've seen a lot of people do some pretty amazing things. There again, we're talking about the realm of faith. We're talking about Christianity. And my friends, you could do all kinds of things, and if you're not doing it in the realm of faith, then it amounts to not a hill of beans. We have to think eternally. Our perspective must always be eternal. According to your faith, it will be done. So faith is the key that opens the door to heaven. So it's very important that you and I grow, we develop, and strengthen our faith. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 says this, faith assures us of things we expect. So if I had to summarize faith, I would say, faith is expecting the best. Now you might think to yourself, well, that's just being optimistic. No, it's not. Faith is not positive thinking. Positive thinking is good. Don't get me wrong. I like being around positive thinking people. What's the alternative? Negative people. And who wants to be around negative people? Bottom line is, positive thinking is good, but it's limited. And it certainly isn't faith. I could put you in the middle of a snowstorm in nothing but your PJs, and you would still freeze to death no matter how positive you are. Being positive, thinking positive about it, doesn't make you any warmer. So positive thinking is good, but there are some things that just can't affect. And when I'm talking about expecting the best, I'm not talking about wishful thinking. Like, I hope I don't have any problems in my life. Well, good luck with that one, because that ship has already sailed. You're going to have problems. You're going to have difficulties. Expecting the best is not saying, you know, I hope everything goes just the way I planned it. Oh, yeah, right. Nothing goes the way we always plan it, does it? There's always some monkey wrench in there. So what I'm talking about, when I say faith is expecting the best, what I'm talking about here, expecting the best is the confident assurance. This is in your notes, in your bulletin. And I put those because somebody said they want me to put notes back in the bulletin. And so if you don't take notes, it's your fault if I take them back out. So you better take notes. Just kidding. Because you can get the outline on the website. Expecting the best is the confident assurance that God is in control of the future and that he plans what is best for my life because he loves me. Isn't that awesome? And the definition for that is found in Psalm 32:8, which says, I will guide you along the best pathways for your life. I'll advise and I'll watch over you. It's talking about your life. It's saying that the pathway in your life is tailor-made just for you. The pathway for your life may be completely different from the pathway for that person sitting around you this morning. My pathway in my life might be totally different than yours. That's understandable because God tailor-made each one of us in a way that he says, basically, if you'll trust me, if you'll get to know me, then you can expect the best because I will guide you in that path that is best for you. It's the best based on who you are and on who God wants you to be and become. So why should I expect the best in life when so many things are going wrong? Why? Why should I expect the best when so many bad things have happened to me already? You know, you look back and, oh. Well, we learn that answer to that question by looking at a famous story in the Bible. Now, you might say, well, we just looked at this, Grant. We had a whole month. We studied about this dude. Is there any more that we can learn? Yes, that's what I love about the Bible. You throw it into a different set of circumstances, you can learn a lot of different things. And so what I want us to look at again, you say, oh, Grant, Don't you read anything else? David and Goliath. Maybe you've never heard the story. But the Israeli armies are fighting against the Philistine armies. And the Philistines had this guy, you know. This guy who was the tallest guy known in the world. He's a giant, Goliath. And I tell you what, he's 9 feet tall. Everybody's intimidated by this guy. He comes out and stands out in front of the armies and says, hey, come on, I'll take you on one or whatever, 1-on-10, whatever. Just bring your best. Take your best shot. And they were intimidated by him. He terrorized the Israeli army, except for one little shepherd boy named David. And David says, I'll fight him. I'll take him on. You know, everybody else is saying, this guy's too big to fight. David's sitting there saying, this guy's too big to miss. Besides, God on our side is one plus God is always a majority. That might be something that you ought to take out of this morning. If you are following Jesus Christ this morning, no matter what you are facing, one plus God is a majority. You don't have to fear anything. And so from this story of David fighting Goliath, we learn three things about how David expected the best and what it does to us. First, when you expect the best, it honors God. There's something about expecting the best. It says something about who you think God really is. And when you expect God to help you, it's the highest compliment that you can pay to God. Listen to what David's attitude was in 1 Samuel 17. He said, this day the Lord will hand you over to me and strike you down, and the whole world will know that there is a God. Now, if you're a dad and you have kids, have you ever had one of your kids say, my dad can do anything? How does that make you feel when they say that? Pretty good, doesn't it? Well, folks, God really can do anything. And when we expect him to do things in our life, it honors him. You know, William Carey, who is known to be the father of modern missions, he was a missionary, obviously, and he changed the world that he lived in his day because of his faith. And he had a mantra that he used all the time, and it was this. He would say, expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. That's what your faith can do for you. Secondly, when I have faith and I expect God for the best, it increases my ability in my life. That's what it did for David. It increased his strength and his ability. David had the strength to hurl a stone from a sling, hit this Philistine right in the noggin, caused him to fall forward, face down. And God gave David that ability because of David's faith. And we've seen it happen countless times, the difference that an attitude can make. The Olympics have shown us that, haven't they? People who have a winning attitude really end up winning a lot of times. Muhammad Ali, who many regard as one of the greatest athletes who ever lived, says the two fights that he lost, he thought something different before those fights than he did any other fight. What he thought was this: if I lose this fight, what a difference an attitude can make. Faith has the power to change your attitude about your life like nothing else will. It strengthens our ability. Again, the story of David and Goliath. He took 5 smooth stones and that tiny little sling, and he went out and defeated the giant named Goliath. Mainstream media, though, came along and said, what kind of faith was it to take 5 stones? Didn't he think God would give him the strength to hit him with the first stone? Well, the Bible's pretty clear about this, folks. Goliath had 4 brothers. And so as David's going out to battle, he's probably thinking, if I defeat one giant, God will give me the strength to defeat the other four, if I have to. You see, when you act in faith, you receive additional strength to face the difficulties of life. We just got to step out, just like the Israelites stepped out into the water at the Jordan River. Stepped out. You know, the water's flowing. As soon as they stepped out, the water quit flowing. Sometimes God's just waiting for us to exercise our faith. We're sitting like, well, you do that, God, then I'll step out. Hogwash. That comes from the Hebrew. Then there's a third thing. When you have faith, it encourages others. The Bible tells us that when Goliath was defeated, the Israelites gave a great shout of triumph, and they rushed after the Philistines all the way to Gath. The entire nation was victorious. The entire nation was energized, encouraged by the faith of just one young man. That's the power that faith has. Everyone gets excited. Optimism is contagious. And faith has the incredible power to make you and I optimistic. George Gallup did a survey, and he found out this, something we're talking about this morning, that faith brings optimism. When you have faith, it makes you more optimistic about life. Gallup discovered that people who have the greatest faith are also people who are the happiest in life and the people who are the most helpful to other people. Faith has the power to make us optimistic. And when you have faith, it encourages the people that are around you that you need to encourage in life. It gives you the strength to face those difficulties. And some of you are saying, well, how can I expect the best? You don't know what I'm going through. No, I don't. And some of you may be facing some giants in your life, some financial giants, some physical health giants, some relational giants. You're facing big issues, and you're thinking, how can I expect the best when everything seems to be going wrong right now? Well, you can do the four things that David did that gave him confidence when he faced those giants. And if you'll do these four things, friends, if you'll do these four things, you will find yourself having a positive, expecting the best kind of attitude, even in the worst situations. And we know what David had to say, what gave him confidence, because David wrote it in a book called the Psalms, where he shares all his personal feelings. So today we're going to look at these four things that David did. And if you'll do these four things, you'll be able to face your giants with confidence. Anybody here have any giants lately? Any of you? I think we all would fall into that category. Would you like to be a more optimistic person? Oh no, Grant, I'm okay right where I'm at. Would you like to be a more expecting the best kind of person? Well, what do you do then? What do you do? Here's the first thing. Tune in to God every morning. First thing, start your day with God. That'll make you more positive. It'll make you more optimistic. It'll make you more a person of faith. That's David's first secret of optimism. Psalm 5:3. In the morning, O Lord, in the morning, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you and wait in expectation. Where does he get this spirit of expectation? He gets it because he spends with time with God in the morning. Before he talks to anybody else, he talks to God. Now, some of you are just naturally pessimistic. You look at that glass and it's always half empty rather than half full. Okay. You identify with that great theologian and pessimist, Eeyore the donkey in Winnie the Pooh. He stood beside the stream, he looked into the water, and he said, oh, pathetic. That's what it is. It's pathetic. He turns and walks slowly down and then crosses a stream and looks back into the water again. He says, as I thought, no better from this side. Nobody cares. Pathetic. That's what it is. Then Winnie the Pooh comes coming out of the woods behind him and said, well, hey, Eeyore, how are you? Good morning, Pooh Bear. If it is a good morning, which I doubt. Do you ever feel like Eeyore in the morning? Do you? How many of you ever wake up grouchy in the morning? How many of you just let him sleep in? Because really, there are only two kinds of people in life. The kind that get up and say, wow, good morning, Lord. And then the others that say, good Lord, it's morning. And that really is the case. And for those of you who feel sluggish, you feel a little negative, a little critical this morning, and you're not expecting the best when you first get up. You're not just jumping up for joy. You're not feeling optimistic or positive. You're a little cranky, a little negative, a little critical, a little cynical about the world. I got some suggestions for you. This isn't rocket science. I'm not even going to give you biblical proof texts for it because it's so logical. Then why are you giving it to us? Because it's good. If you wake up. If you wake up cranky, down, do this. Go to bed earlier. I made a decision a long time ago. This isn't set in stone. If I have something going on Saturday night, I'll go do it. But I don't usually try to do anything on Saturday night. Why? Because I don't want to come in here all down and cranky and a little worn out and tired. Now, that's not to say I sleep perfectly every night. But I do it because I want to give God my best. And sometimes we come in here and we've spent late nights for Saturday nights. We come in here, we're tired, we're crying. I don't really want to be. I'd rather, you're just thinking about that Nazarene nap you can take this afternoon. And it's because you're worn out. It's hard to be optimistic when you're sleep deprived. It really is. And no wonder, I mean, when you have to wake up to an alarm, you wake up in shock. It's a no-brainer. Go to bed earlier. It's easy for you to say, Grant. Well, yeah, but it's truth. Another thing is, don't turn on the morning news. First thing you do is turn on Bad Morning America. You start listening to that, or you listen to the local news and you hear about, oh, we had 3 murders last night, 2 rapes, and a house burned down. You know, if it bleeds, it leads. That's how they are. Then you pick up a newspaper and read the newspaper and you hear all about China and the Wuhan virus and all that's going on with that. Then you go in the car and you turn on the radio and you listen to somebody talking about everything else. And no wonder you're cranky. That's all you've been listening to. That's all you're listening to. You need to start your day with good news, not bad news. Don't listen to all the problems of the world as you're starting out your morning. Because in that process, in that time, your mind is forming your mood for the day. Third of that, start your day with worship. Tune into God before you talk to anybody else. Listen to some good CDs, good Christian music. It really is. It lifts your spirit. Haven't you ever felt that when you're watching the news on, and all the junk going on? Don't you just feel your spirit getting down? Because all it is negative. Why would you do that to yourself? Here, take some of this strychnine. It'll make you feel better. Well, it'll kill whatever's in there, but it'll kill you in the process too. Read some promises of God. You see, study after study after study has shown that your mood for each day is determined by the first 10 minutes of that day. You can be a little more intentional about expecting the best. If you'll just start your day intentionally with worship, just focus on God. You know that great verse, "This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." It's a choice. Optimism releases endorphins into your brain. You'll actually feel better if you start the day by tuning into God. Second thing. You want to expect the best. Think on God's promises throughout the day. That's David's second secret to optimism. In fact, Psalm 119:95 says, "Though the wicked hide along the way to kill me, I will quietly keep my mind upon your promises." You see, he was constantly facing assassination. People were looking constantly to try to take his life. And so he's facing this constantly. And then Psalm 119:11 says, "I bank your promises in the vault of my heart." So how are you going to think about God's promises throughout the day? I mean, if you're like me, you're out, you know, jogging 4 or 5 miles a day. You don't have your Bible with you. Did I say something funny? So it's best if you know. It's best if you know God's promises that you can draw on. You know, there's thousands and thousands and thousands of promises God has in his word just for you and me. All we got to do is just start memorizing them and putting them in our heart and mind. Here's a good one. This is a great verse. This is one that probably everybody ought to have memorized. Philippians 4:8. Now, this is from the Message, so it sounds different than what maybe you're accustomed to, but this is what it says. You'll do best by filling your minds and meditating on things true, noble, reputable, authentic, compelling, gracious, the best, not the worst, the beautiful, not the ugly. That's great. Philippians 4:8. Take that. Doesn't sound like the fall lineup of television, though, does it? You won't find that. So let me just say, listen to something different. If you're going to have a change of heart, if you're going to get rid of the anxiety in your life, if you're going to feel less threatened in life, more hopeful, expecting the best, start by listening to something different. Listen to God's promises. They have power to bring faith and optimism into our lives. Hebrews 10:23 says, let's keep a firm grip on the promises that keep us going. He always keeps his word. That's what it says. So each week, memorize a verse. It's a great way. It's only 52 verses out of the year. Try Hebrews 11:5. This is one that you've already heard. There's a little different rendition. Without faith, no one can please God. Of course, I said it earlier. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. Just a different rendition. But it also continues and says, anyone who comes to God must believe that he's real and that he rewards those who truly want to find him. And if that's too much for you, at least just learn the first part. Without faith, no one can please God. At least do that much. And watch the difference it begins to make in your life and your spirit. The third secret of expecting the best is trust in God's love, even when things look bad. Even when the circumstances look bad and bleak and depressing. In Psalm 42, David said, oh, my soul, don't be discouraged. Don't be upset. Expect God to act. For I know that I shall, again, have plenty of reason to praise him for all that he will do. That's the Living Bible. Notice it says it's in the future. It says he will do. He's going to do. He hasn't done it yet. That's a statement of positive expectation. He's saying circumstances look dark right now. I'm not going to get down on it. I'm not going to allow it to drag me down, but I'm going to expect God to act. He's done it in the past, and he'll do it again. He'll get me out. Some of you might be going through some dark times right now. What do you do? Well, first, you remember how God has helped you in the past. And you know what? Sometimes we need to remember God has helped us a lot of times when we weren't even aware that God was helping us. Till maybe down the road a little bit. And then secondly, expect him to do it again. Here, Grant, let me help you here. Throw me a little carrot. Here. I'm going to let him fall next time. Watch that. No, that's not the God we serve. Expect the best. You're trusting in God's love, even when things look bad. You see, we rarely understand why God allows some of this stuff to happen in our life. We're sitting there always wanting, why did this happen? I mean, this is sort of a silly little illustration, but, you know, I was getting ready to go on vacation in August, and my truck, which only had 4,000 miles on it at all, something happened. I don't know what it was, and they said it was a sensor. Oh, it'll be a week. I got vacation coming up. You know, that's important. Then they call and tell me, well, Grant, it's probably going to be several weeks. What am I going to take on vacation? You know, those crazy guys, they gave me a loaner, a Ford Expedition with all the bells and whistles. I had so much fun on that thing. Retractable mirrors. I mean, heated steering wheel. Sue likes it really cold in the cab, so I mean, my hands get frozen, so I have to turn on the heat. I could have sat there and just wringed my hand. What am I going to do? And God provided me something even better. Now, I didn't even have to put any miles on my truck. But I'm just saying, God provides. He takes care of. Why do we sit there and worry and fret? Just trust God. Expect the best. I didn't deserve that expedition. Thank God he let me have it. So what do you do when you're in a difficult situation and it doesn't make sense? You trust in the love of God. You don't have to have all the rationale. Why is this happening to me? We probably wouldn't understand it even if he told us. All we got to do is just trust God. Okay, God, I'm going to trust you. You see, this is a deep, deep, deep level of faith that God wants each and every one of us to grow into. Hebrews 12:10, while we were children, our parents did what seemed best to them, but God is doing what is best for us, training us to live God's holy best. That's in the Message. So here's the key. If you want to handle the dark situations of life, you got to look at them from God's perspective. What was the Israeli army doing when they were looking at old Goliath? They're looking at Goliath and thinking, you know, this guy's impossible to beat. Nobody's ever going to be able to take him down. But not David. David was looking at Goliath from God's perspective and say, here's this guy. He's defaming, he's defiling God. And God is on our side and God will help us out. We'll bring this dude down quick. You see, it's all on how you look at the situation. And see, we, as Christians, shame on us. Oftentimes we have something adverse happen in our life. All immediate, we begin to look at the negative. Rather than the fact, I'm a child of the King. I don't have to worry about anything. Oh, it might be uncomfortable. So what? There have been plenty of martyrs out there that were a lot more uncomfortable before they drew life's last breath. There's another promise you might want to even memorize. Psalm 91:14. I'll get you out of any trouble. Oh, I like that. I'll give you the best of care if only you'll get to know and trust me. Isn't that a great verse? That's what God wants to do. That's why God's been trying to get our attention. I'll take care of you if you just get to know me and trust me. And that brings David to the fourth secret of optimism, expecting the best. That's why we're here. Talk with other believers. David hung out with positive people. He wasn't just facing this giant alone. He had emotional and spiritual support. Psalm 119:63, I'm a friend and companion to those committed to living by your rules. So you need to associate yourself. You need to attach yourself to, you need fellowship with other people of positive faith. So that begs the question, then who do you hang out with? Does your faith get any support at all? You see, if you hang out with cynical, sarcastic, critical, negative people, that's as contagious as faith is, and they'll tend to infect you. If you want to be a person of great faith, great expectation, you need to find people who will build that into your life. Because the wrong kind of crowd will bring you down. What's 1 Corinthians 15:33 says? It says, bad company corrupts good character. And it really does when it comes to our attitude, folks. It's like that old cliche. If you want to soar with eagles, you got to stop running with turkeys. Bottom line. Psalm 1. I just got this today and I had to write it down, so I put it on a sidecar. Psalm 1, verse 1, in the Message, it puts it this way. You've heard it before, but how well God must like you. You don't hang out at Sin Saloon. You don't slink along Dead End Road. You don't go to Smart Mouth College. Some of our teens do, though. I'm sorry. Did I say that? Instead, you thrill into God's Word. You chew on Scripture day and night. I love that. David didn't hang with cynical people. He didn't do that because he didn't want their stuff infecting him, their negativity. And I'm not telling you today that you need to go out and drop all your negative friends. But somebody said everybody needs one or two neurotic friends just as projects to influence them. You don't want to get a whole lot of them, but just a few. Because you need more VIPs in your life than you do VDPs. Well, what's the difference? Well, a VIP is very inspirational people, and they will lift you up. A VDP is a very draining person, and they will drag you down. They will. You got to get more VIPs in your life than VDPs. Because if you have more VDPs, I tell you what, there's no way that you're going to be a person of faith. And that's what we're trying to become. That's what we're trying to grow and develop. So you got to get some VIPs. Of course, the most logical place that you can do that is in a Bible study or a small group, or just as what we're doing here this morning, which Scripture is so very clear. It says, let us not give up on the habit of meeting together. Instead, let us encourage one another. That's what we do as we gather here. You see, the average American lives just over 25,000 days in their life. Now, some of you are above average. But that's the typical lifespan of an American citizen. Of that, do you think that you could set aside some time and give that time to God to grow your faith? But then the question is, do you really want to grow in your faith? Tune into God every morning. Think on God's promises throughout the day. Trust in God's love even when things look bad. And then talk with other believers. Will you pledge to do those four things this week? We probably have all done them at one point in time in our life. But we need to be more consistent. The world is watching. They need something that has consistency, not this up and down stuff. Will you pledge this morning to begin to make these four things part of your daily routine, part of your daily life? It'll make a huge difference on your faith. You'll look back even from a week from today and look and think, wow, I had a good week. Not because bad things didn't happen. Bad things might have happened. But you didn't allow it to get you down because you trust in God. We serve an awesome God, but we also serve a God who wants us to be walking billboards of what Christianity truly is. The world doesn't have too many of those, and we need to be those kind of people. Will you let me pray with you? Bow your heads. The Bible tells us that we need to keep company with God and get in on what is best for us, what He has for us. Folks, I don't want you to sit on the sidelines. I want all of us to get involved in what God is doing. But maybe you just need to pray right now. Maybe you just need to ask God one question and then wait for that answer this morning. And here's that question. God, do you want me to grow in my faith through the following weeks? If you've asked that question, I just want you to wait right now. Wait for an answer. God, do you want me to grow in my faith through the following weeks? It may just be an impression in your heart, maybe it's an actual yes. And if that's the case, would you just pray, thank you, God, in advance for all that you're doing in my life. I'm expecting in faith. And in this place, I'm sure some of you might be worried about giant problems. Maybe there's a Goliath in your life. Maybe it's a lab report from a doctor. Maybe it's a situation at work. Maybe it's a family issue that just has been dragging you down. Maybe it's an important decision that you're going to have to make in the next few days. Will you just be willing right now to take what we've talked about this morning through God's Word? Would you just be willing right now just to relax in Jesus? Just take a deep breath and trust Jesus and say, Jesus, I want to put my trust in you and I expect the best. And it's in your name I pray. Amen. I want us to listen to this song as we close this morning. It's called Give Me Faith. You want to sing along, you can. But I want you to feel challenged this morning to begin to do these things that we talked about. And if you just say, well, I'll think about it today. Nah, you won't do it. You got to determine that you're willing to do it. These four things. And if you forget, I'll put it on the website so you can go back and look. But let's sing this song together if you feel compelled to sing. Give me faith.
Fail, but my God, you never will. I may
God, we thank you for giving us the opportunity this morning to hear from your word. We ask now as we leave this place, as we put into practice what we've heard, because, Lord, if we don't take your word and apply it to our life, it means absolutely nothing. But, Lord, we want to grow in our faith, and so I'm asking, God, that, Lord, you'll help each and every one of us take those steps necessary, that, Lord God, we'll begin to see our faith begin to blossom like it should. We'll begin to see you do things in our life that maybe we never dreamed possible. But because, Lord, we took these steps of faith, Lord, we began to see you work miracles after miracles. We love you and thank you. Thank you, Lord, for these wonderful people who've come here today, and ask your blessing on each one. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you. Thanks for coming. You're dismissed.